Hello everyone, today we're going to talk about one of Germany's most famous prototype tank destroyers. This is more commonly known as the PZ-SLF Führer K40, also known as the Sturer Emil these days. However, this name was never actually used by the Germans at the time. There were only two examples made of this vehicle, and these were named Moritz and Max. They were named after these characters who plagued their own town with pranks, but at the end, the adults exact their revenge. The name for these vehicles will seem fitting at the end. The name for these vehicles was documented by Panzerjäger Abteilung 521st Commander Kurt Hildebrandt. The idea for this armored fighting vehicle came from the idea to use the remaining chassis of the abandoned VK3001H project. Not a lot of people know why they actually never saw mass production, but it is generally accepted that this tank would have been outdated the moment it hit the battlefield. So a lot of people believe that they abandoned it because they had better projects to pour their materials and attention in. When they saw they had some chassis remaining, they allocated two of them to have the 128mm main armament fitted on them. However, the chassis needed some adjustments to be able to fit this massive gun. The chassis had to be lengthened by 1.5 meters, which triggered changes to the suspension. A pair of road wheels were added to each side. The return rollers were moved. The number of track links increased to 85 per side. The torsion bars of the last two pairs of road wheels were strengthened to compensate for the increased load. The evacuation capsules were kept, but they had to be completely redesigned to move backwards. The one on the left was used by the driver, but the one on the right was completely blocked by a fuel tank. But it did have a ladder fitted inside, so you could jump over the sides because the vehicle had an open roof. Of course, having an open roof is a disadvantage to itself. I mean, you are vulnerable to planes, you're vulnerable to grenades, you're vulnerable to Molotov cocktails, you're vulnerable to snipers, and so on and so forth. So it is a disadvantage. It was also outfitted with a smokescreen and headlights. The vehicle was also equipped with FU-SPR-GERA radio. Its antenna was located at the right side of the casemate. Like I said before, it had a 128mm main armament. This main armament was based off the 128mm Flak. This was an incredible gun, but it was equally as heavy. It weighed a mighty 12 tons. But it was one, if not the strongest SPG gun used in combat. It could penetrate up to 200mm of steel angled at 30 degrees at a distance of 100 meters. As you can imagine, no Allied tank had enough armor to resist such firepower for the entire duration of the war. However, it's probably smart to mention that it was never meant as an anti-tank gun, but more as an anti-fortification gun. Its ammunition consisted of 15 rounds, where 8 were armor-piercing and 7 were high-explosive rounds. These were housed in special racks on the side of the fighting compartment. This is not a lot, this is far below average. According to one of my sources, this main armament was very much comparable to the 130mm of the Soviets named the M46. The 128mm could do plus 10 degrees and minus 15 degrees in elevation and depression, and 7 degrees to the right and 5 degrees to the left. One of the disadvantages it had was that the engine was fitted in an awkward spot. It was directly under the gun. This meant that repairing it would be very difficult, especially in the field. But to make access easier, the floor was made of hinged wooden panels. And despite having a theoretical top speed of 25 km/h, this vehicle could not even get past the 20 km/h mark. The Sturer Emil wasn't even very heavily armored. Its thickest point was only 50mm thick, which would make you vulnerable to basically everything and anything the Soviets had at the time. So in my opinion, this is a prime example of not being spotted is the best armor. Service history. But before we get into this, I'd like to ask you guys if you could please subscribe to my channel. I see that only 9% of you guys who watch my channel are subscribed, so if you are part of the 91% and you enjoy my videos, please subscribe. Now here we go. Both the PZ-SLF Führer 128mm K40 prototypes ended in Jutenborg in May 1942. It joined some vehicles and a refurbished PZ-SLF-4A into a special platoon in the 521st Tank Destroyer Battalion. The crew started to settle in their vehicles, and that is when they started to change their vehicles. The false driver's cabins were removed from the vehicles at the same time, and holders for spare track links were added to the left and right of the gun. Holders for spare track links were also added to the front plate as well. In addition, according to the photographs, the second PZ SLF Führer lost its headlights. The final look was significantly different from their first form. When deployed, Max quickly started showing engine trouble, so most of the work fell to Moritz and the tank nowadays known as the Brumbar. Moritz's crew attained impressive results during the fighting in July. The number of confirmed kills is not known, but one picture showed 31 kill marks on the barrel. However, Max didn't sit idle either. His barrel did too show kill marks, but it weren't as many. In general, the tactics of using these vehicles for long-range shooting paid off. Nevertheless, the soldiers did not like the heavy tank destroyers that much. First, the ammunition capacity was too low. Second, the suspension was overloaded, especially in the rear. As a result, they had to repair it frequently, often in the field. Intensive use made its mark on these vehicles, especially Moritz. The rear was overloaded, which led to rapid wear on the road wheels. The 521st Tank Destroyer Battalion remained in the 6th Army through the fall and winter of 1942. Sadly, the information on the combat performance of them is sparse. It is only known that both vehicles were part of the battalion on November 12th and were fighting near Stalingrad. As of December 1st, one of the vehicles was listed in the battalion. Presumably, Max was lost by then. The 512th Battalion ceased to exist in January 1943, sharing the fate of the 6th Army. Moritz fell into the hands of the Red Army. At the moment of its capture, Moritz was undergoing repairs and it had several wheels missing on the right side. Interestingly, the number of victory marks on the barrel was reduced to 7. Perhaps it has something to do with the change in crews. Due to the missing road wheels and the lack of ammo, the agility and the gunnery trials were skipped. The description was composed using information from prisoners of war, which pointed out that the SPG was used in a special unit. This unit was tasked with fighting Soviet medium and heavy tanks on long range. The prisoners also said that firing on mobile vehicles from the heavy SPG was difficult. After the vehicle was studied, it was sent to Gorky Park and it remained there for quite some time. My opinion. In my opinion, there were a lot of things wrong with this AFV. Like I've said multiple times, this tank was too heavy. The suspension was simply overloaded, especially the rear. As a result of this, they had to repair it frequently. In addition to that, they had almost no ammunition storage. In addition to that, the engine was also in a very unfortunate place, which made repair difficult. Also, another downside of the weight was that towing it off the battlefield would be extremely difficult. Its main advantage is that it had a great gun, but the shells were quite heavy. I saw one source claim that the weight of one round would be about 50 kilograms or thereabout. So you can imagine that reloading it would take some time, and another issue was the lack of armor. Like I previously said, it had a maximum of 50mm of armor, and this is just simply not enough. I mean, everything of the Soviet Union could take it out. The cost of this vehicle was also very high. It cost a lot of money to be made, and you could make 2 or 3 Hetzers for one Sturer Emil. So as you can imagine, this vehicle wasn't made for mass production. Anyway, to show me you've watched the entire video, please comment your favorite tank in the comments. We also have a Discord link which will be in the description and in the comments, just like my Instagram page. We also just made a squadron on War Thunder, so if you are interested in that, just search for Learning History Together or LHTYT. And then we have a KV-1 video on the left and a tank playlist on the right, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Have a very good day.